On to the first topic, systemic approach to an infertile patient by Dr. Erika Patel. She's educated in MBBS from DY Patel Medical College, New Bombay, and MSOG in Sumandi Deep Varoda, and MC Therapeutic Medicine and Surgery in 2017 from Sri Ramachandra Medical College. Currently, she is pursuing integrated PVC in reproductive medicine at SRMC and is a consultant in Nova IVF Fertility Center. With this introduction, I call upon Dr. Erika Patel.
Depending on the age of the patient, we will proceed with the treatment. 35 years, we can just observe if the duration is less than 18 months. If even after 18 months, the patient is not conceiving, then we can induce the patient with clomiphene citrate or letrozole and do IUI. IUI is a very simpler version of infertility treatment where we just process the semen of the male partner and inject it inside the female. So intrauterine insemination is the preferred. We can do that for 3 cycles. If that fails, we can use gonadotropin injections and do the same. And if that fails, only then and then we will proceed for IVF. So this is very important to know because there is a lot of practice going on where if the patient comes to us, the patient is directly subjected to IVF. So it is very important to know that there are a lot of things which we can do and achieve pregnancy before actually subjecting the patient to IVF. If the patient is 35 to 40 years, the success of IUI is very less beyond 3 cycles. So we can try 3 cycles of IUI and then immediately proceed for IVF. A patient more than 40 years is a patient who should directly go for IVF because we do not have time to waste in doing smaller treatments and then the patient's age becoming even more where achieving a pregnancy through IVF is also impossible. If in the hysterolaparoscopy we found any abnormal findings, we can correct those findings. Coming to ovulatory factors, how do we diagnose reduced ovarian reserve? Reduced ovarian reserve is something that we have recently started seeing a lot in practice. Usually earlier, probably a decade ago, it was only females who were more than 35 years of age were presenting to us with a decreased number of egg count due to the age factor. However, in the recent past, we have seen a lot of younger women also who are having a very low egg count. It could be attributed to lifestyle and environmental factors. So first thing that we do is evaluate. We should not assume that she is a 25-year-old female and hence she will definitely have a good number of eggs. We must evaluate. We should do the FSH and the estradiol values. Clomiphene citrate challenge test was done in the past, but now it is not very useful. Since we have a very good and important marker that has come, which is the fourth number, that is the AMH, that is anti-mullerian hormone, which is a very specific marker for ovarian reserve. A value of 2.5 to 4 is considered to be normal. Anything less than 2.5 is less and anything less than 1 nanogram is very, very less. So how do we diagnose these ovulatory disorders? I'll come back to that again. We'll go with the uterine factor. This image is pretty self-explanatory. If we see there are multiple problems that could be there just in the uterus, which on correction we can probably achieve a good pregnancy. A uterine septum which can be easily resected by a hysteroscope. A small fibroid which can be removed and pregnancy can be achieved. Any small polyps that can be removed. If there is any pubal blockage, we can try to open this block by tubal surgery. Any infections can be treated. Endometriosis is a very tricky thing when it is in the ovary. Any other endometriosis can be ablated. But an ovarian endometriosis, we have to be very careful of touching it because it will also, destroying that endometriotic lesion will also destroy a lot of eggs that are there inside the ovary and hence it may reduce the ovarian reserve of the patient. So when we have an abnormal cavity of hysterosalpingogram, we can have intracavitary masses like fibroid and polyp. We can do a sonohistrography and resect them. And then we can just observe an additional treatment only if indicated. When we do all these surgeries for correcting the uterine and tubal factors, after that we must give the patient at least 3 to 6 months to try naturally because just correction of these factors will lead to an increased chance of fertility. They need not go for IVF or IUI. We can give them 3 to 6 months to try naturally. also. However, two surgical failures is when we can go to any other options like adoption or a surrogacy. Any Mullerian abnormalities where there is a septum, we can consider metroplasty by dividing the septum and unification surgeries. Biconvert uterus, conservative treatment. Biconvert uterus does not lead to infertility per se. There is pregnancy that can be achieved in a single corner of the uterus as well. Coming to tubal factor, this also is a very important thing to see because these days we have a common practice that even if one tube is blocked, we directly subject the patient to IVF without thinking if that could be, there could be any other reason or if this block can be removed. Most of the times what happens is when we do a hysterosalpingography, the patient is awake, it is not done under sedation. We are just injecting the dye and taking the x-ray. So because of a slight vasovagal symptoms, there could be just a spasm which you misdiagnose it as a block. So sometimes giving an atropine and doing a HSG will show you open tubes. So whenever we find an abnormal histogram, we first see whether the tube is, whether the block is by both the sides or on a single side. Suppose it is a bilateral block, if it is a distal block, we can go for IVF. However, if it is a proximal block, we can actually repeat the HSC and check whether it was not just a spasm of the tube. And we can also do a hysterolaparoscopic tubal cannulation and remove the block before directly taking the patient for IVF. Unilateral blocks, we can repeat the HSC and do a laparoscopy. Sometimes doing a laparoscopy where the patient is under sedation, under anesthesia, and just pushing the dye forcefully can also open up these blocks. Distal blocks, same, we can do tubal cautery and remove the blocked tube. Check the contralateral tube. If the contralateral tube is normal, we can definitely go for IUI treatment. The only thing we see here is we will check on which side of the ovary is the dominant follicle forming. If it is the right tube is open and the egg is forming on the right hand side, yes, we can definitely give them a chance for that cycle to try that. If all of this fails, is when we go for IVF. Laparoscopy is fairly simple. When we do it, we correct it and we go for IUI and then IVF. If it is not correctable, only then we go for IVF. Coming to male factor infertility, male reproductive history is very important. Causal frequency and timing, there are a lot of times by getting into the details of the causal frequency, we get to know that the cause probably is nothing but just a wrong causal practice or a premature ejaculation or any erectile dysfunctions. Duration of infertility and previous fertility, any childhood diseases like mumps. Mumps in puberty for males is a very important factor for having semen abnormalities. And the WHO semen analysis reference guideline says about 15 million per ml is a minimum sperm count, a 32% of progressive mortality, and a 58% of vitality. Basic hormone tests in males, so there is a very limited number of investigations that we can do for the male partner. If the semen analysis is normal, that is if we stop there and there is no need for any other investigation to be done. Only and only when the semen count is abnormal is when we do the FSH, LH, testosterone and prolactin and diagnose if there is any hormonal deficiency or excess. So coming to semen analysis, if we see abnormal parameters, always, always, always repeat the test. For men, the semen production is there every 72 days. Hence, their daily activities, any recreational drugs, any tobacco use is going to affect. Even a small thing like a viral infection or a sore throat does affect the semen count and the quality. Hence, it is very important that if once the infection is settled, we retest the semen. And we most of the times do find a better semen report than the first one. If the sperm count is as less as 10, less than 10 million and motility less than 20%, we do karyotyping and proceed directly for IVF fixing. If the count is more than 10 million but still not matching with the WHO criteria, there, then we can go for intrauterine insemination for about 3 cycles, and if then it fails, we can go for IVF. So concluding, a couple with 12 months of infertility, we do both male and female analysis. Male evaluation, semen analysis, normal, you pursue other etiologies. Abnormal, then you find out the reason why that is abnormal and assess the need for ART referral. Female, you first do is ovulatory evaluation. Then assess for tubal patencies and uterine factors, and then see if it can be surgically corrected. If the patient is anovulatory, then find out what is the reason for anovulation, what are the hormonal abnormalities, whether thyroid, prolactin, anything is playing a role in it, and treat the underlying causes, and then consider ovulation induction. After that phase is when you can assess the need for ART referral.
Yes, sir.
Sir, abdominal tuberculosis, what we have seen is it depends on how many years ago it was there. Suppose the patient has completed the entire 9 months course of tuberculosis, there can be two things. One is we have to first check the tubes, because the tuberculosis firstly affects the tubes. If the tubes are infected, then there is no point of asking the patient to try naturally, we directly go for IVF. If the tube has hydrosalpinx, we actually clip the tubes and close the tube, because that fluid, when it enters the uterine cavity, it is very toxic to the embryo. So we clip the tube and then we proceed for IVF. And the second biggest problem we have is the endometrium is destroyed by the tuberculosis bacteria. So we do a hysteroscopy prior, we take the endometrial tissue, send it for TDPCR and see if that is positive or negative. If it is negative, we can definitely proceed in the patient. Otherwise, some patients have complete destruction of endometrium. Earlier we used to suggest surrogacy for them, but now PRP is working very fine for endometrial regeneration. So we do 3 or 4 cycles of PRP instillation in the uterine cavity and then try to proceed for IVF.
Your experience in tuberculosis,
Tuberculosis, sir, we used to do it quite a few years back, but the biggest problem we were having is ectopic pregnancies. Still, if there is a single side of tube that requires a tuberculosis, we still go for it, but otherwise we prefer IVF for these patients. Because even if we achieve a very good result, there's a very high chance of ectopic pregnancy, which could be worse than that.
Thank you. Now welcome Dr. Geeta Sridhar to come and sit with you. Thank you. Thank you.
Madam.